Keokuk County is a great place to live. How do I know? Well, I've lived nearly half of my 101 years in the county. We're proud of the 11,624 people who live in the 16 incorporated towns, and we are sure we'll carry this part of the world into the 21st century. The Keokuk County Sesquicentennial Commission proudly presents this brief sketch of Keokuk County and these 16 towns. We wish that you would research further the Whatcher's Historical Society and the Keokuk County Historical Society at Sigourney. We thank you for all of the video material, all of the material, pictures, material that will go into our video. In conclusion, it is our wish that this heritage that we have may be enriched beyond measure as the citizens of this county move into the 21st century.
Keokuk County is located in the center of southeast Iowa and is 24 miles square. Surrounding the counties are Poweshiek and Iowa on the north, Washington on the east, Jefferson and Wapello on the south, and Mahaska on the west. This prairie grass scene might be the way this area looked when early settlers arrived.
The Sac and Fox Indian tribes occupied the area which later became Keokuk County.
The county was named for a chief of these tribes who was friendly and believed in keeping peace with the white man. In 1837, the first land of the county was opened to white men who soon began staking claims in Richland, Clear Creek, Jackson, and Lafayette townships. The entire county was open to settlers May 1, 1843. By this time, many of the Native Americans had moved to sites west of the Missouri River. However, some remained in the area for a number of years.
The first task facing the settlers was to build sod or log cabins for their families. Often, several families would live together in one cabin until others were built.
As towns and other settlements were being established, schools and churches would soon start up. Both were vital parts of any community. The first Christian church in Lancaster, with everyone turned out in their Sunday best, is an early example. Early country schools might be represented by Connor School south of Sigourney as it looked in 1913. Many communities sprang up throughout the county. When the railroads arrived, some towns were abandoned and new towns were started along the rail lines. Some of the 50 or so abandoned town plats are shown here. The people who settled in this county were, as a rule, poor people. But though they were poor in purse, they were rich in the many traits of character that go to make up good citizens. The early settlers of our county needed very few laws for their government, but the enforcing of those laws required at least a minimal amount of organization. Therefore, in 1844, following designation of a site for the county seat, a cabin was erected by a Mr. S.A. James. It was located on what would become the south side of the square in Sigourney, and it was the first, quote and unquote, courthouse. At the first meeting of the Board of Commissioners, their first action was to order an official courthouse to be built. This would be located on the north side of the square at the current site of the Sigourney News Review. An oak log cabin was built and also functioned as a school, church, and even a resting place for weary travelers.
The location of the county seat was a controversial issue for the time the county was organized in 1844 until finally resolved 13 years later by action of the Iowa Supreme Court. It was argued that the location should be in the southeast part of the county because the settlers were more numerous there rather than being in Sigourney, the geographical center of the county. A vote of the people in August 1846 mandated that the county seat be moved to Lancaster, a new community initially called Lafayette and located 5 miles southeast of Sigourney. At Lancaster, a second courthouse was built. Being completed in 1848, it stood at the southeast corner of the public square, was 2 stories high, and was made mostly of walnut wood. This building was later used as a farm residence 1/4 mile west and finally storage before being raised about 1960. The location of the county seat in Lancaster during the years 1846 to 1856 was commemorated on August 18, 1996 with the placement of a historical marker on the public square near the former Lancaster School. The marker was provided by the Keokuk County Sesquicentennial Commission. The program at Lancaster included an address by Neil Smith, a native of Keokuk County, born in Steady Run Township, and for 36 years, a United States Congressman. Another vote of the people, this one on April 12, 1856, directed the county seat be moved back to Sigourney. After the Iowa Supreme Court validated the relocation of the county seat, a 2-story brick courthouse, the third built in Keokuk County, was constructed in 1858 on the site the present courthouse occupies. The present courthouse was erected in 1909 and 1910 after the previous structure was torn down. Early photos show a crowd gathered at the cornerstone laying and another shot showing further progress in its construction. It was dedicated September 16, 1910. From its earliest beginnings, agriculture has played a major role in Keokuk County's development. Early pictures show haying before the advent of the baler, a threshing crew, a close-up of a thresher taken in 1914, and a bit later, bringing the produce to market. Agriculture has changed tremendously since these pictures, but continues to be a major economic factor. Agriculture-related businesses are also important in the county. Cap Miller of South English is credited with starting rural youth clubs, which later became 4-H groups, which are still very active in the county. Both the Keokuk County Expo and the Keokuk County Fair provide an arena for agriculture-related activities for youth as well as adults in the county.
Early newspaper banners, the Iowa Times in 1896 and the News in 1897, attest to the fact that Keokuk County citizens have always been interested in being informed. The first paper in Keokuk County was the Western Friend, published in Lancaster in 1854. Many others followed, such as the Keokuk County News, this building still exists in disrepair, an early newspaper office probably resembled this one. Keokuk County can be very proud of the health services offered to county citizens. The Keokuk County Health Center and the medical clinic staffed by University of Iowa Hospitals provides a variety of services in Sigourney.
Physicians' offices are also located in Keota and Hedrick.
Keokuk County has contributed generously in man and woman power to 6 wars, a monument to Civil War veterans, and another monument honoring Keokuk County veterans of all wars stand in the county courtyard. The 16 towns in the county, in order of their purported incorporation, offer a brief sketch of their history. Richland settlers arrived early in the spring of 1838. They were Aaron Miller and his son John. The first child, pictured here, born in Richland, was Levi J. Bales. The town was laid out on June 16, 1841 by Prior Woodward, one of the first settlers. His tombstone is in the old Methodist Cemetery. It was first suggested that they name this new community Frogtown, because of all the water that had gathered after a heavy rain. But when the sun came out and dried the land, it was decided that because of the richness of the land, they would call it Richland. The town was built in the shape of a square with a beautiful round park in the center. Many businesses formed around the square, some of which were hotels, grocers, doctors, dentists, and many others. Part of the west and north side of the square is shown in the 1930s, showing a large crowd at Hendrickson's horse sale. The first school in the county was taught in a crude log cabin by James McKinney in 1842. The Richland Academy was started in 1856. Shown is one of the buildings used from 1894 to 1925, and then the last school used in Richland before the reorganization into the present Pekin School District. The Quaker Church was organized in 1841, with meetings being held in a log cabin. The Methodist Church also began in a log cabin, and later they built a small frame building. In 1848, the Christian Church was organized, and the Catholic Church organized a parish in 1946. With the organization of the churches came the cemeteries. Three cemeteries were created: the Methodist, which is shown, the Friends, and the Highland. All of these are located on the north side of town. Many clubs were formed early, including the Independent Order of Odd Fellows, the Rebecca Lodge, and the Masonic Lodge. Others were to follow later. Livery barns were plentiful in Richland from Civil War times on through the early 1940s. The first newspaper was established in 1871 by Walter Smith. In 1881, J.D. Haworth established the Clarion, a weekly publication which has been published ever since, although ownership has changed many times. Richland had the first post office in the county in 1844, and it was located in a small building on the square. The Iowa Central Railroad ran through the south edge of Richland in 1882 and later became known as the Minneapolis and St. Louis Railroad. With the advent of the railroad, hotels flourished. Thompson House, built in 1848, is an excellent example. The M and St. L moved in the 1930s, but Richland is still home to the Milwaukee Railroad, which is north of town. Richland had a large tile and brick factory which was located just south of the Milwaukee Railroad on the east side of the road. Many of the bricks were made here for the brick buildings around the square. The original Richland Public Library, which began in 1938, was located in one room at the rear of the fire station and opened with 200 donated books. In 1996, the Richland Public Library serves our community as a wonderful resource. Richland's first firefighting equipment consisted of two hand pumpers built in 1902 by Charlie Steele. Two eras are represented by these pictures, the first 1946 and the second 1976. Several trucks have been purchased and many years have passed. However, Richland still has a large volunteer fire department to serve our area. An important part of Richland's history is the Opera House. It was built by John Stroop before the turn of the century and was a wonderful place to gather to view a variety of plays, musical shows, and other events. The Opera House is no longer in use, although still intact. Richland's first bank was created in 1891 by John Stroop and A.F. Bridger and was called Stroop Bank. Later, the name was changed to Union Bank and is now owned by First Star Bank of Ottumwa. Late in the 1890s, a telephone exchange was established. Later, it was absorbed into the Iowa, Illinois Company, which installed the dial system in 1953. For many years, light was supplied to the town by a gas plant. Then, in 1915, a franchise was granted for an electric light plant, which generated its own electricity. Today, electricity is provided by IES Utilities. In 1952, a water system was installed in the community and later a new water plant was added. The first doctor in Richland was Dr. W.H. Tingle in 1845. The community's medical needs are now met by the Medical Arts Clinic. Macy Mills was the town's first veterinarian, and today Dr. Gene Hoy operates the Richland Veterinary Clinic, servicing this area. Many years have come and gone since these first settlers came to Richland to make their homes, and many businesses have come and gone, but one thing is certain. Richland continues to be a community of hardworking individuals with a lot of pride and spirit like our first settlers had when they were building Richland. Many businesses continue to thrive in this community. Three commissioners, George H. Stone, John A. Stewart, and Samuel Shuppleton, were appointed by the territorial legislature to locate the seat of government for Keokuk County. The original appointment papers hang in the supervisor's office in the courthouse. The location of Sigourney was made by Dr. Stone, and the name also was the choice of the doctor. He had always been a great admirer of the writings of Lydia Huntley Sigourney, a famous poetess of the time. Born in 1791, she wrote long and flowery poetry and hymns. She died in 1865 after a writing career of 50 years and with the publications of 56 volumes of poetry, tales, novels, biographies, and letters. Some of Mrs. Sigourney's descendants have visited Sigourney, one such time being in 1994 when Sigourney celebrated their sesquicentennial. Sigourney became the county seat in 1844. In 1846, the seat of government was moved to Lancaster, where it remained until 1856 when it was moved back to Sigourney. The first schoolhouse, a frame building 16 by 24, was erected in Sigourney in 1850, previous to that time having been held in the old courthouse. The second schoolhouse was a two-story building containing four rooms. By 1880, there were two commodious brick schoolhouses, the first North Ward and the first South Ward. These were later replaced by the second North Ward and the second South Ward. None of these buildings are still standing. The original high school has since been removed. In 1996, Sigourney Community Schools is housed in two buildings, a high school, junior high school facility, and an elementary building, both of which have undergone major remodeling and additions in the past 5 years. Sigourney is justly proud of their school facilities and the opportunities offered the youth of our community. We have joined the technology world with computer labs in both schools and a fiber optics connection at the high school. The first religious organization formed in Sigourney was that of the Methodists in 1847. Many others followed. The congregation of the Evangelical Church has merged with other denominations, and their building now houses the Keokuk County Historical Society. In 1996, we have Cavalry Christian Church, Baptist Church, Presbyterian Church, United Methodist Church, Christian Church, Church of Christ, St. Mary's Catholic, and Hope Lutheran to minister to the community's religious needs. As was true in all parts of the United States, railroads played an important role in Sigourney's development. The Rock Island came from Washington in 1872, and the Milwaukee from Cedar Rapids in 1883. One of the early industries was the Sigourney Woolen Mill that stood in the area of what is now Phelps. Other industries included fanning mills, iron works, button factory, wagon factory, and Crott Brothers manufacturing of carriages, buggies, and farm wagons. In 1996, we have Lewis Rich, the Bender Foundry, and just beginning, the Duralast plant. Sigourney citizens have always been social-minded and in good times have gathered to watch parades, attend political rallies, hang out at one of the hotels, scoop the loop with friends, join the happy hour club, laze away a summer afternoon, or in more recent times, who gathered during Sigourney's sesquicentennial celebration of 1994. Residents rise to the occasion during the bad times to help friends and neighbors, as during the tornado in 1984. After the slump in the farm economy of the early 1980s, Sigourney, as well as other towns in the county, sought ways to revitalize their towns. Citizens of Sigourney, through the guidance and resources of the Sigourney Area Development and the Main Street Sigourney organizations, are addressing the community's quality of life issues. Today, we have three industries. Two of these industries are located in the new industrial park, which was financed privately by local citizens in 1994. Commercial properties are being given attention, and a new interest in preservation has filtered into the residential areas. New homes are being constructed throughout the town. A recent bond issue was passed to preserve and maintain the neglected Memorial Hall, which houses the city offices. Grants for infrastructure improvements, preservation, and cultural arts are being pursued. Attitudes have changed, and the 2,111 citizens are demonstrating a new pride and energy level. Sigourney is undergoing a metamorphosis, both physically and mentally, and a fresh, positive outlook for our future prevails today. In the mid-1840s, the first settlers began arriving in the Webster community, making the long trip from the east by covered wagon. The community grew and the town was platted in 1854. It is not known how the town came to be called Webster. Being on the Montezuma-Muscatine Divide, Webster came to be a place of considerable business. This was the route over which lumber and other freight was hauled by wagon from Iowa City to Wachier. With both a livery stable and a hotel, Webster was a good stopping place for the wagons. By 1854, there were enough people in the town to have their first postmaster. The post office was for a time housed in the general store. In 1855, the first post office was built. 100 years later, in 1955, the present office was built. Early businesses included general mercantile stores, a hardware store, blacksmith shop, drugstore, a bee supply house and poultry business, and even a chicken picking business. The early history of the town boasted that there had never been a saloon in Webster, a statement few towns could make. However, that changed in later years. Probably the largest business ever in Webster was the grain elevator and stockyards. The railroad played a very important part in Webster's history. Interestingly, Webster became the crossroad of the CBRNN, which was later leased to the Rock Island Line and the Chicago-Milwaukee-St. Paul. No doubt the intersection of the two railroads contributed to the growth and prosperity of the region. It resulted in extra business and increased taxes for the town and school, transported goods for the businesses, provided transportation for the town folks in all four directions, transported the mail, and provided a way for area farmers to get their grain and livestock to market. The Webster Bank opened in 1903. It was a two-story brick building of which the top half was an opera house and was also used as a meeting place for the Women's Temperance Group. It also housed the telephone office. The bank went bankrupt in the 30s, causing many people to lose their savings. As the community grew, the need for more schools grew. each township had their own schools. These were usually 2 miles apart. Webster's first school was built in the fall of 1854. This building was used until it burned in 1881. Soon after, another school was built in the east part of town. This building at first housed 10 grades. 11 and 12 were added later. In 1915, a new brick structure was erected after four rural districts, Lincoln, Morgan, Grimes, and Polk, were united into a consolidated district. The school served for 40 years before joining with Kinross, South English, and North English to form the English Valley School District. The building was torn down in 1980. Only the ball field remains. At one time, the town had two churches, the Congregational and the Methodist. The Congregational was built in 1871 and the Methodist in 1873. The Methodist Church was organized in 1853, but until the church was built, the services were held in homes, the schoolhouse, and also the Congregational Church. The Methodist Church still stands and still teaches the fundamentals of Christian faith, and it provides a bond of love and fellowship to the community. Webster is served by a volunteer fire department operating from a new fire station with the most up-to-date equipment, which is a far cry from the old bucket brigade. The town has dwindled from the town of many years ago with a lot of businesses to a town with only two, the post office and the grain elevator. The population has decreased over the years, but it still prides itself on its clean, neat appearance and friendly people.
On August the 1st, 1863, South English became a part of Iowa's history. On that day, George Cyprett Talley, a Baptist minister and Southern sympathizer, was the main speaker at a rally held in North Singer's Grove. His views were not appreciated by many Northern sympathizers. Excitement ran high and many altercations took place. The rally concluded as Talley and his supporters headed home to Ioka in the southern part of the county. They passed the hotel where a Northern supporter had been addressing a group of people. Talley's men were all armed as they approached the hotel. 18 Loyalists ran to get weapons. Harsh words were exchanged as store owner Tom Mormon came running down the street, his revolver accidentally discharged. Both groups opened fire, many shots rang out, and Talley fell mortally wounded. Talley's supporters threatened to burn the town of South English if no arrests were made for Talley's murder. A mob gathered, and Governor Kirkwood dispatched troops from the state capital in Iowa City to control the mob. Sheriff Adams arrested some men and they agreed to appear before the next district court. This still did not satisfy the mob. Governor Kirkwood came to Sigourney and spoke very pointedly that no violence would be tolerated. Those arrested were later found not guilty. This event took place at the corner of Monroe and Main Streets and was the only death recorded in a confrontation in the state of Iowa during the Civil War. Notarized papers found many years later revealed that a local Union soldier, home on medical discharge, shot Talley.
In 1845, the John Houston family was the first to settle in South English. The location of their cabin would have been to the right of this picture of Monroe Street. This building stood at the corner of Monroe and Main Street at the time of the Talley incident. It housed a drugstore. The first newspaper published in South English was the Advance. In 1872, an article stated that the construction of the Coburn Boyd Millinery Shop was being delayed due to a railroad survey. W.W. Yarram published the first issue of the Advance in 1872. It was later known as the Western Herald and the South English Herald. The last issue was published by Donald S. Garrett in 1942. When the railroad from Muscatine to Montezuma came through South English, many of the business buildings were moved from the old town site to the new town, and the population had grown to 450 people. White's Emporium, a general store owned by J.F. White, was one of the buildings that was moved. The South English Brick and Tile Factory operated from 1880 through 1913, manufacturing brick and tile. It is thought their brick were used for the construction of the Opera House and the Farmers Savings Bank, which now houses the modern cooperative telephone office. This is the earliest picture of the South English business area, dated 1882. A one-room schoolhouse took care of educational needs until 1883, when a two-story building was erected for grades 1 through 10. The school was enlarged in 1917, housing 12 grades. The last graduating class of 1949 had one senior. The structure was demolished in 1981. In 1890, J.F. White and Sons opened and operated a private bank. Then, on August 17, 1908, the White State Bank was chartered as a commercial bank and is still in existence. D.N. Kaufman was the proprietor of the corner store in 1890. His daughter was the telegrapher. The telephone switchboard was located there in later years. The adjacent building was a hardware store. To fulfill the growing needs in the early 1890s, a hotel was built and known as the Dillaway House. In the summertime, the town band often played from the second story balcony. The town was incorporated in 1892. The vote was 44 for incorporation and 39 against. This picture of Horn and Clark General Store was taken in 1895. Their services ranged from selling dry goods to pulling teeth, as well as housing the post office. The Oddfellows Lodge built the Opera House in 1896. In addition to their meetings, school and community activities were held there. Other fraternal organizations met upstairs in later years. This house, built at the turn of the century by Theodore White, son of J.F. White, is on the National Register of Historic Places. Early churches in South English were the Christian Church, Baptist Church, and the Methodist Episcopal Church. Today, only the Union Church and Baptist Church remain. Built in 1912, the bandstand's lower floor served as storage for the firefighting equipment, which was a steel drum mounted on a two-wheel cart. Local musicians performed concerts on the main floor of the bandstand until 1940. This brief history brings us up to the 1940s. There have been many changes in our town since then. We have a smaller population, but we retain great pride in our community. Our sesquicentennial event will take place in our city park, which was established in 1990. And now, you are entering Wat Chir's story of its early days in Keokuk County. As early as 1843, it was known that there were large deposits of coal in the present Wat Chir area. By 1880, the town had a population of a few hundred. In the next 3 years, there was such a rapid development of the coal mining industry that Wat Chir suddenly jumped to 3,700 and became a second-class city. Wat Chir became the coal mining center of Iowa and a bustling business center for the area. In 1911, the Wat Chir Clay Products plant was built, and it became the largest manufacturer of sewer pipe and other clay products in the Midwest. It, like the mines, was soon a thing of the past, even though some coal and vast quantities of clay remain and the potential is still there for future development of the area. At this time, there is still in operation a clay plant that makes fancy clay items. Wat Chir also had an early pottery that made artistic vases and other items. It was operated by Johnny Nelson. Over the years, Wat Chir has seen its share of floods, fires, and major storms. Some of these are portrayed in these early photos. Along with its industries came various modes of transportation. which included the railroads that existed until the late 1950s and early 1960s. We are also home of the original Keokuk County Fair. The grounds are still used for an annual fair and also the location of three annual flea markets known as the Collector's Paradise. Huachir has four churches, the Baptist, Christian, Methodist, and Hilltop Chapel. Huachir is a part of the Tri-County School District. The Tri-County School District was the first reorganization in Iowa to involve as many as four towns. Huachir has a Superior Fire and Rescue Department. There are six EMTs and five first responders among our firemen. Four fire trucks and a medical van fully equipped stand ready to answer any emergency that might arise. They also now have in their possession an antique bell which they have restored. It is believed to be over 100 years old. It is a fire bell of yesterday for sure. We are the hometown of the world-famous Huachir Opera House, now restored. Oh, if its walls could talk, many tales it could tell of the past, present, and the future. We also have the Huachir Brick School Museum, formerly East Elementary School, that houses many old relics of days gone by. Over the years, many businesses and industries have come and gone. Huachir is a city with a very fruitful past, still looking to its future. Maybe some of its past will help its future become reality once again. Harper, as seen here from the air, was initially settled by German immigrants. Although through the years, early immigrants from other European countries also settled here. In the early 19th century, various religious, economic, and military problems brought immigrants from Germany to America. In 1844, the Peter Besser family left Germany for America. They traveled by steamboat to Amsterdam, where they boarded the American three-masted trading vessel Harry Shelton, bound for New York. After sailing for 28 days, they reached America. From New York, they traveled to Quincy, Illinois, where Mr. Besser left his family to seek a permanent settlement. He reached Burlington, Iowa, and finally the small settlement of Dublin. There, he heard of a new territory recently purchased by the government from the Indians. He purchased a 40-acre tract of land for $50 west of the Clear Creek area. He then brought his family from Quincy by steamboat up the Mississippi to Burlington, where they embarked upon their journey by prairie schooner to their new home. Arriving in September 1844, they immediately began work on a log cabin. Mr. Besser died of malaria in October 1844. Because of his widow's correspondence with friends and family in Germany, people became familiar with the new country. By 1847, other families were arriving here and bought land for $1.50 per acre in German Township and created the new settlement of New Baden, named for their home in Germany. The name was quickly shortened to Baden. This town was laid out in 1865 by Sebastian Striegel, original owner of the 40-acre tract and one of the early settlers. Roads bounded the south and east sides of the settlement. The South Road is now Highway 92. Streets were named and houses built. As the first town in German now Plank Township, Baden thrived and prospered. A Catholic church was built in 1857. A parish rectory was built and the first Catholic school in Keokuk County was built there. In 1872, the Rock Island Railroad was being built from Washington to Oskaloosa. The company had promised to pass through Baden, but instead located 1.5 miles northeast of Baden. In 1876, the church was moved to Harper. The present St. Elizabeth Church was started in 1883 and finished in time to be used during the Christmas season in 1884. In 1873, a one-room building was built to house a Methodist church. In the early years of Harper, the Methodist community was very active. Over the years, attendance had dropped and the church was closed in 1957. Telephone service was brought to the community in August 1896. The switchboard was operated by various people out of their homes until 1915, when Mr. and Mrs. John Crooks erected a small building on their property which served as the telephone office. This building has been moved to the fairgrounds in Des Moines to be part of an historical site. During 1929 and 1930, right-of-way was purchased from farmers in the area for construction of a natural gas pipeline. This pipeline was built to carry gas from Texas to Chicago. A booster station was built just south of Harper. Many people from Harper, Kyoto, Sigourney, and surrounding areas have been employed there. In 1933, W.C. Greder purchased the Farmers Union elevator and started buying grain. He had previously been buying and shipping livestock. In 1958, the present grain elevator was built. It is still owned and operated by his family. In March of 1996, rural water was brought into town and a new water system constructed, which added to the quality of life here. Over the years, Harper has had a creamery and cheese factory, a tile factory, banks, a newspaper, hardware store, blacksmith shop, several doctor's offices, barbershop, bakery, dry good, grocery stores, drug stores, clothing stores, shoe stores, taverns, livery stable, grain elevators, natural gas pipeline booster station, and post office. Of all these businesses, only the post office, hardware store, grain elevators, and pipeline station still exist. The town was begun and remains an agricultural community surrounded by very fertile, productive farmland. Harper, with a present population of 150, is a pleasant town in which to live and raise a family. Over the last decades, it had become a town of mostly retired people, but over the past few years has seen more young families with children as residents. Hopefully, this will bring about a revival of civic pride and perhaps even new businesses. Kyoto is located among the beautiful rolling hills of Keokuk County and was the site of a buffalo wallow. Drainage from north farm fields made it necessary to build the second largest tile factory in the state of Iowa in 1883. The town of Kyoto was laid out in 1871. The CRINP Railroad reached Kyoto in 1872 and was incorporated in 1873. In 1877, Kyoto had 95 businesses. Some businesses of note were River Products Company, 1873, Oregon Factory in 1873, and Eagle Glass Factory built in 1879. Five Singmaster mansions were built between 1895 and 1917. Elmhurst was built by Thomas Singmaster in 1905, now a bed and breakfast owned by Marjorie Kaler. Singmasters built many horse barns and cottages for horse trainers. Legus, one of the Singmaster French Percheron draft horses, was world champion stallion in 1915. He died in 1926 at the Singmaster Maple Grove Farm. In 1902, J.O. Singmaster, North Ranch Maplehurst, had pasture for buffalo, deer, and elk. The Kyoto Eagle newspaper was started by G.C. Miller in 1875. It has been published by the Richardson family for many years. The Central Cafe has been owned by Pearl Mound and family since 1954, where friends meet and eat. The State Banking House of Henkel and Littler and Company and the Kyoto Loan and Savings Association were started in 1875. Three banks have served the community. Farmers Savings Bank was started in 1893. This building was erected in 1970. R.O. Wilson willed money for the Wilson Memorial Library. It was dedicated in 1954. The handicapped accessible edition was dedicated in 1995. Kyoto City Hall and Kyoto Volunteer Fire Department Incorporated building was dedicated in 1979. Kyoto Volunteer Fire Department was organized in 1884. The incorporation purchased a 55-foot aerial ladder quint pumper in 1995. J.K. Mound has been the fire chief for the last 35 years. Lagos Acres Country Club, swimming pool, and nine-hole golf course was built in 1964. The swimming pool was rebuilt in 1995. It was built at the site of A.D. Stewart Home. Maplewood Manor Nursing Home was built in 1965 on the site of Howard Stewart Home. Extended care units were added in 1995. Lyle Insurance Agency Incorporated was started by James Lyle in 1878. Pioneer Mutual Insurance Association was started in 1856. H.P. Newton was the first secretary for 30 years. Charles White, our building contractor, is the fourth generation from Hosea Newton. Olson's Farm and Home Drug closed in 1995. On the second floor of this building was the Kyoto Hospital that was in business from 1913 to 1917. Powell Funeral Home has served the community since 1955. Three generations of the Powell family have been associated with the business. Kyoto Senior Citizen Center serves congregate meals. The building is owned by the seniors and was dedicated in 1980. Fagan Elevator has been operated by the Don Fagan family since 1946. Some say there was a grain elevator since 1880. Greter Motor Company has been in business since 1946. F.D. Greter bought the business from Claude Holmes. Tom Getter, F.D.'s son, is now the owner. Wesley United Methodist Church has made improvements since 1915. In 1973, the church joined a Yokefield charge with the United Presbyterian Church. St. Mary's Catholic Church was dedicated in 1950. St. Mary's Parochial School was dedicated in 1964. Students now attend Kyoto High School. Kyoto Elementary School was dedicated in 1960. Kyoto Community Junior Senior High School was dedicated in 1972. Kyoto shares a sports program with the Sigourney High School. Rayman Incorporated manager is Ray Eakins, site of formerly Tadlock Incorporated. Equipment has been designed and built to fit the need. Farmers Co-op was started in Sigourney and came to Kyoto in 1961. Dave Hobscheit has been manager for over 16 years. Vitito Slat Flooring Incorporated was started by Mr. and Mrs. Francis Vitito in 1966. They are building successful innovations for agriculture. Senex Land O'Lakes Agronomy Center has been owned by other companies through the years. Tamley Hometown Market is our grocery store. Sewer and water systems were installed in 1914 and 1916. In 1958, the city dug a well to the Jordan Aquifer. Many improvements have been made and will continue to be made in future years. We wish to recognize our courteous people at our many businesses. These include Kyoto Post Office, Lawyers Lang and Railsback, Beauty Shops, Service Stations, Westendorf Emporium, Woltering Poultry Products, Kyoto Meat Processing, Baron Motor Supply, Insurance Agents, Feed Salesman, Cassin's Mill Corporation, DJ Gallery, Tennis Davis and Dill Trucking, Plumbers, Ideal Ready Mix, Maplehurst Genetics, The Roost, County Line Mart, Mailey Hardware, Kyoto Clinic, Altenhofen Crafts, Bermel Laundromat, our Fix-It people, and all the farmers in our community. We are extremely proud of our schools and businesses in our community. Did you know the fourth letter of the Greek alphabet is Delta? Delta, Iowa, in Warren Township, is in the western part of Keokuk County on Highway 21. In October 1842, the Indians gave up the land by treaty in the area where Delta and surrounding farmland is located. No claims were allowed until May 1, 1843. Each man could stake a claim of 160 acres plus a small timber patch of not more than 40 acres. This land could not be purchased until 1846 and was sold for $1.25 per acre. A.J. McNabb journeyed westward with his family from Indiana, stopping over in Washington, Iowa. With the date of May 1st in his mind, Mr. McNabb with others hurried to Keokuk County to take up claims. His claim contained much of the land which later became Delta. Early settlers included Max and Randall, Jacob Kinsler, E. Sampson, and James Landers. The stagecoach passed these farms, and the nearest town was Springfield, which was laid out in 1845. Springfield was a thriving town until the Rock Island Railroad decided to lay its tracks south of town. A.J. McNabb proposed to give the railroad right-of-way through Warren Township. W.T. Wharton and G.W. Dunn offered $100 each to have the railroad built on the site proposed by McNabb. Alan McDonald offered to give land if this site was chosen. Mr. McNabb gave the land north of the tracks, and Mr. McDonald gave the land south of the tracks, with the depot being built on McDonald ground. Grading began on May 1875. Now the town needed a name. The chief engineer of the railroad, G.W. Fay, looked at the drawing board with the plat of the town and saw the resemblance of the fourth letter of the Greek alphabet and said, that should be the new town's name. Delta it has been for 121 years. The depot was built in 1876. The first passenger train arrived in Delta February 2, 1876. The depot closed in 1955. The last train went through Delta July 6, 1967. Mr. H.R. McGuire, station agent for 40 years, related remembering 400 cars of livestock shipping from Delta in a year and two passenger trains daily, 6 days a week. The Delta Christian Church was established from the Springfield Christian Church. The first church was built in 1876 for $2,000. A second larger church was built in 1900. This building had a large auditorium and was used for school and community affairs. It was destroyed by fire October 27, 1929, and a brick church was built. The Christian Church and the Methodist Church are the two remaining churches. The Delta School was founded in 1877 and continued until 1966 when it joined the Sigourney Community School District. Classes were held until 1974. Since then, the building has been used as a community center under the title of the Delta Town and Country Center. There is a one-room country school in its original location in good condition near Delta. It is the Burr Oak School, currently owned by Clayton Krill. Delta had a tile factory in the early 1900s, also a gas plant which furnished gas for churches, some homes, business places, and the street lights. One of the streetlight posts still stands in front of the Delta Grocery. Adam Herrick recalled riding his bicycle to light the streetlights. There was also a pickle plant in the 20s and 30s. And here is one of the service stations taken in 1927. The Delta Covered Bridge, located about 2 miles southeast of Delta on the North Skunk River, was built in 1869 and is reported to be the oldest covered bridge in Iowa. It is Pennsylvania Burr Arch Truss type construction designed by Max and Randall and is the only bridge of this type west of the Mississippi. There is a park near the bridge in a very scenic, quiet setting. We invite you to come see our bridge, our town, and the great people who live in Delta.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Iowa. Happy birthday to you.
Thornburg was established in 1879. Located in Prairie Township, Keokuk County, Iowa. The name Thornburg, with an H on the end, was given in honor of Major Thomas H. Thornburg, who was killed by the Ute Indians in Colorado. Major Thornburg was a friend of J.W. Barnes, the civil engineer who was platting the new town site, and suggested the name. It was the postal department who dropped the H and thus became Thornburg. Thornburg became an intermediate station on the new Burlington, Cedar Rapids, and Northern Railroad to Wachier in 1879. In 1880, the line was extended from Thornburg to Montezuma. Thornburg became a junction point on the Muscatine to Montezuma line for business to and from Wachier, with extensive storage sidetracks and scales from which to facilitate the movement of coal shipments from the Wachier to Thornburg districts. In this connection, the railroad maintained two or more switch engines and crews for the distribution of empty cars to the mines and the assembling and weighing of loaded cars of coal. During that period of development, Thornburg grew to 1,000 in population. It had a physician and an undertaker and at least 14 other businesses. Throughout the years until the early 1930s, the nationally known Bruce Goldfish industry was conducted on 80 acres 1 mile east of Thornburg. There were 18 large ponds fed by springs and windmills used in the propagation of goldfish, which were shipped by Railroad Express to every site and territory in the Union. Doug and Joyce Bender currently live there. Today, Thornburg has a population of 100 with a United Methodist Church, the Tri-County Community Schools, a post office, and 16 cemetery. The United Methodist Church was established in 1880 with services held in the depot. The first church was built in 1881 and a larger church was built in 1916. It was destroyed by fire in February 1925 and rebuilt in May 1925. The church celebrated 100 years of Methodism in 1980. Church services are held each Sunday in 1996. 16 Cemetery was organized in 1907. It's located 2 miles from Thornburg on Highway 21. It is well known for the peonies when in bloom outlining each driveway. July 1, 1956, Tri-County Community School District came into being. Area including Gibson Independent, Keswick Independent, Thornburg Consolidated, Wachier Independent, and portions of rural school districts in Iowa and Poweshiek counties. Tri-County Community Schools combined in 1963 with the high school at Wachier, elementary at Gibson Keswick, and junior high at Thornburg. The Thornburg building was built in 1965 with occupancy in August 1966. It housed high school while the old Thornburg building housed junior high. In December 1991, the new Thornburg addition was completed and classes began January 2, 1992. The first post office was built in 1879. The new post office, a modular building, was opened January 4, 1995. White Oak is located 2.5 miles northeast of Thornburg. The United Presbyterian Church was organized in 1869. In 1871, William Johnson deeded 2 acres for a church and cemetery. The church was built in 1884. In 1915, the ceiling of the church was lowered, and in 1946, the belfry and steeple were removed, and the basement and entry were added. In 1969, the White Oak United Presbyterian Church celebrated 100 years, where services are still held in 1996. We would like to give special thanks for the preparation of this material to Don Bittinger, Greta Moore, Diane Smith, Margaret Calvert, Gail Moore, and Jeannie Boss. First, only a depot on the newly laid Central Iowa Railroad in 1882. A name for the depot? Why not call it Ollie, after the pretty Ollie Fye, said the railroad boss who was dating her. After all, the land on which it stood was settled by her father, William Fye. Now that merchandise was transported by a railway, a trading center soon flourished and residences were built. merchants and craftsmen moved from nearby Ioka that had been denied a place on the rail route. Among the first buildings were the hotel that housed the first post office on the south side and three small buildings on the north side. The building of a grist and sawmill in Ollie eliminated the trip to Manhattan Mill on the South Skunk River, 4 miles away. The little town grew with a livery stable, groceries, general stores, drugstore, hardware, furniture, and undertaking, millinery shop, dressmaking, barbershops, harness shop, creamery, and even the ladies' friend washing machine factory. Older residents remember the pickle factory, lumberyard, the blacksmith shops, and cobbler shops. Farmers were served by the Ollie Grain Company and the stockyards that stood by the railroad later owned by the M and St. L. The town progressed. However, fires, the depression, and other means of transportation saw a decline in the railway use. The last train passed through Ollie in 1935. Today, as a result of fire and wrecking, few Main Street buildings remain. A memorial park reminds us of buildings once there. Education has always been important. The old Marshall School followed the earlier schools, then the Ollie School, followed by the Ollie Consolidated School in 1921, until a desire for more advanced education resulted in forming Pekin Community Schools in 1961. The desire for worship of God resulted in three churches in the community through the years: the Methodist, Ollie Baptist, and Church of the Brethren. Recently, Grace Family Center, west of Ollie. With the merging of Methodist churches, a new Methodist church is being built on Highway 78. Social life in Ollie has been a source of entertainment. Bands, celebrations, ball clubs, motorcycle clubs, gun clubs, Masonic and Odd Fellows lodges, Lions Club, Ollie Community Club, and Ollie Area Betterment Club have served this purpose. Another source of entertainment were the opera houses, Babers and Fies, the latter destroyed by fire, the former built over the Terrell Hardware by R.L. Baber, who wrote many of the plays produced there. The unique theater, last operated by Dayton Dump Frederick, was built by his father and operated many years by him. Dump was known as the piano tuner in his later years, but earlier traveled with Schaffner shows as a ventriloquist, actor, and musician. During the Depression, he ran outdoor movies in many surrounding towns. He and Jack Hafferty built many of the projectors that were used during that time. Dr. Charles McGinnis and Dr. C.A. Schreiner served the community many, many years as doctors. In nearby Rock Creek Cemetery are the graves of George Cypress Talley, victim of the Skunk River War, and J.F. Searcy, first white child born in Keokuk County. Northeast of Ollie in the Brethren Cemetery is buried Charles E. Wunderlich Sr., one of Napoleon's soldiers. Today, Ollie has Food, Drink, Interesting Conversation, FDIC, in the former bank building adjoining the grocery store, a tavern, an insurance office, the post office, and service station make up the business section of the town today. An efficient township city fire department and the community building in the park are also important to the citizens of the area.
Founded in 1882, Hedrick is in the extreme southwestern corner of Keokuk County, just off Highway 149. Hedrick was named after Civil War General John Morrow Hedrick, who encouraged its development. The population has varied from 1,000 to the current 810. Since its heyday of three railroads, seven churches, and its kite-shaped mile racetrack and amphitheater, torn down in 1900 for land development. The last train rolled through in 1980, and all tracks were removed. The Union Depot was purchased by Merle Klingman and was moved to this site in 1975. Formerly his real estate and antique business, it will shortly house a new enterprise. As we enter Hedrick on Main, going south, we see on the left the 32-unit Hedrick housing, built in 1975. Past Northrop Insurance on the right, we find the Benton Township Fire Station, constructed in 1972 and maintained by a very active volunteer crew. Turning left to Park Street, we see Circle Memorial Park, with its two-story bandstand reconstructed in 1989, commemorating the original one built in 1901, and recalling many band concerts and celebrations. Nearby on Park Street is Centennial House, refurbished in our centennial year 1982 and owned by Marilyn Barry. It reflects the lifestyle of days gone by. Across the street on the left is the Christian Church, established in 1893 and rebuilt in 1947. Hedrick's Main Street brick paving was laid in 1919. Our annual celebration, Barbecue Days, is the last weekend in June. Begun in 1959 by the Lions Club, it is now a cooperative venture. Several buildings have remained constant on Main. This former Hedrick Journal building is now a beauty shop, Dixie's Main Street Salon. Hedrick's first building was moved from Slagle. It now houses Tony's Barbershop. The old Central Hotel site is now Dr. Barry's chiropractic building. Peter's Drug and Winter's Cafe building is now Rao Apartments. The present Hedrick Cafe is the site of Hedrick's first post office. The Arndt Boland Stubbs American Legion Post 83 was founded in 1919, and the present building was completed in 1957. The former Reese Nace Barbershop building now houses a laundromat. The old State Bank and Hedrick Savings Bank building is now Mosby's Apartments. The present post office building was built in 1966. Across the street on the left is Dr. Blaylock's Veterinarian Clinic, housed in the former Shoddy residence. The Hedrick Savings Bank, built in 1969, was remodeled in 1994. Hedrick is proud of its community center, library, and city hall, dedicated in 1985 and built entirely from donated funds. The water plant was built in 1977. Our town's elevation is marked at the water tower as 822.472 feet. This is the new site of the Klingman Real Estate. The next building has served as a grocery store for many years. The Blaine Financial Investment Building is the oldest original wooden structure and is served as a bank, telephone office, drugstore, gift, and flower shop. The Hedrick Journal, established in Hedrick in 1889, now shares this space. The former First National Bank building and adjoining bus barn is now known as the Johnson Building. Next door on 2nd, Dr. V's Medical Clinic occupies the original Dr. F.C. Perkins office. These horseshoes in the adjoining pavement mark the site of the John Birch Blacksmith Shop. The Brain Elevator has been a landmark since 1948. Across on Spring Street is Mosby Oil Company, owned by the present mayor, Bill Mosby. Nearby is a Methodist church founded in 1886. In 1963, this new building was dedicated. Also on Spring is St. Paul Lutheran Church, built in 1906. It has historic stained glass windows and an ornate hand-carved wooden altar. Going west on 2nd Street, we find the Keith Norris home, the original Hedrick site, first called Waugh's Point. The Hedrick school system was consolidated with Pekin District in 1991 and the school building removed. The auditorium and gym, built in 1950, remains and serves as the Carl Craft Civic Center in memory of its custodian. Perkins Recreational Park across the street was donated to the city in 1980 by the Perkins family. It includes ball diamonds and tennis courts, and restroom, facilities. Hedrick is proud of its updated sewer and water system, its natural gas and cable, and its parks. We are presently involved in an urban renewal program designed to attract new and reconstructed housing, as well as new business. Hedrick, where friends meet, invites you to be part of its progress.
Martinburg was laid out and the town plat was recorded on November 11, 1854. The town of Martinsburg was named after a Daniel Martin, who moved here from Ohio. Martinsburg in 1880 supported a post office, hotel, some prosperous business houses, and a flourishing lodge. Records in Washington, D.C. show the first postmaster to be Thomas Fleener in 1855. Martinsburg still supports a post office in 1996. In the early 1900s, Martinsburg boasted and supported such businesses as Peter's Drugstore, Kupka and Wolfert General Store, Martinsburg Mill, the Train Depot, Deering Machinery, Dr. E. Quinn Store, the Presbyterian Church, which was torn down in the mid-1930s, and the Martinsburg United Methodist Church, which was built and finished in 1861. This church was destroyed, and a new building, the third, still stands and holds services each Sunday. The hotel was destroyed by fire in 1941. As the town grew, it saw such businesses as two gas stations, two cafes, a barber shop, a lumber company, hardware store, bank, garage, blacksmith smithy, well drilling, produce, creamery, telephone office, two doctors, and a school, first grade through 12th grade. The high school was closed in 1948, but grade school continued and was eventually closed and consolidated into what is now the Pekin Community School District. In the early 1930s, Martinsburg was known as the Garden Spot of Iowa, with two large painted signs proclaiming such at each edge of town, erected and placed by A.E. Dahlstrom. Martinsburg began to suffer, as all small towns in the 1940s, when the focal point of a small town is taken away from them, such as our schools. Welcome to Kinross. Nestled in the northeast corner of Keokuk County, Kinross, Iowa, is a little town which has never had more than 100 residents. Prior to the railroad, local citizens were served by the Chandler Post Office in the center of Liberty Township. The farmland of William and Mary Conger was purchased for the placement of a depot, and the village of Kinross was designated on August 19, 1879. As the railroad system developed, farmers in the region prospered as they were able to distribute their produce to a hungry nation and growing Midwestern cities. In Kinross, businesses also prospered. The businessmen of Kinross in 1897 represented various trades: hardware store, livery stable, dry goods store, lumber and implement dealer, blacksmith, livery and hotel, general store and elevator, restaurant, bank, postmaster, depot agent. The former business area is now in ruins on the south edge of town near where the railroad was located. Near the turn of the century, Kinross had a business district which ran north up Broadway Street to the school. This area was destroyed by fire on August 20, 1901. A four-building complex which housed the bank, post office, and stores owned by the Fisher family was built in 1900 to accommodate Kinross's growing enterprises. With the West Side Fire, the brick block became the primary business center of the community. Inside Fisher's general store in the brick block, Robert and Hubert Fisher served the community for decades. Inside Clayton's Eckerman Grocery, the only surviving Broadway Street business was at the foot of the hill near the depot and Fisher elevator. For most of the 20th century, this building housed the Kinross Tavern. On the north edge of town, a school was built in 1901. This two-story, four-room structure was not adequate for long, as a high school and gymnasium was added in 1929. There have been 418 graduates of Kinross High School. Along with their studies, they have fond memories of enjoyable activities, sports, and music. In the schoolyard behind the school, the basketball team of 1925-26 posed with coach W.G. Byroff. The broom, by the way, was his own unique teaching tool. They placed fourth in the state tournament in 1953. The girls' basketball team, coached by John Boslog, has been a source of community pride for over 40 years. The last horse-drawn school buses of 1929. By the 1930s, Kinross Consolidated Schools served all of the children in the township. In 1958, Kinross joined English Valley Community School District, and the building was used as a junior high and then upper elementary center until 1971. After that, the building served as the New Salem Mennonite Church and was eventually purchased by Brad Allison. There have been several churches in Kinross, with the school being used as the Mennonite Church in the 1970s as a more recent example. This photo shows the first church in Kinross, the Methodist Episcopal Church, built in 1890. By 1915, this church was closed and converted to a home. This photo shows the original Church of Christ in Kinross, built in 1912 and destroyed by fire in 1915. The congregation then erected a stucco structure diagonally across the street. The Church of Christ now stands south of the post office. The Sacred Heart Catholic Church also still stands proudly at the northeast corner of Kinross. In 1905, this church was established by Father John Murphy of the Little Creek Catholic Parish north of Kinross, near the site of what was once Hinkletown. St. Patrick's Church of the Little Creek was built in 1875 and dismantled in 1965. The cemetery still serves the community. The Christian and Catholic churches of Old Kinross still stand as community centers. So does the post office in the heart of town. With the passing of the railroads and the decline of small farms, the business activity of Kinross is gone now. Most of the townspeople work in other places such as Amana Refrigeration or Iowa City. As a bedroom community, however, it still is a peaceful place to live and a wonderful place to raise a family. Much has changed in Kinross as it was founded as an agricultural railroad town and then became a bedroom community on Highway 22. With the recent addition of rural water and the developing regional interest in small town living, the community still looks forward to the 21st century. In In 1879, the town of Keswick came into being when the railroad went through this part of the county. The generally accepted story is that our town was named after Keswick, England. In 1912, the town was incorporated. The first school, built in 1880, was a frame building. In 1895, a high school was opened in the Oddfellows Hall. The first brick school building was built on Churchill Street. In 1917, the present school building was erected, the first classes being admitted Monday, February 11, 1918. The last graduating class was in 1956. This building is still being used by the Tri-County School District. We have two churches in town, the Catholic Church and the United Methodist. In 1939, the ME and the MP churches merged, becoming the United Methodist, located in the MP church building. The depot was built in 1880. Margaret Kincaid, the last agent, retired in 1957. The last run of the train was May 19, 1971. Through the years, there have been many businesses in our town. Tile factory, creamery, hotel, barbershop, drugstore, including a pharmacy, three newspapers, butcher shop, ice house, hardware stores, implement dealers, beauty shops, furniture store, three grocery stores, a funeral home, and a jewelry store. We have had doctors, dentists, and chiropractors. Long gone now are the racetrack and fairgrounds, as well as the theater and bandstand where summer concerts were held. The first switchboard was set up in 1904. Mabel Cameron was the first operator. James Moore, who was blind, operated the board from 1908 until 1916. The last operator was Mildred Cranston. Since July 1960, dial service has been provided by the Modern Cooperative Telephone Company of South English. Several banks have served the Keswick community. Keswick Savings Bank, capital of $15,000, the Cover Banking Company, capital of $30,000, and Farmers Savings Bank. In 1930, the last bank closed. In 1945, banking services again became available when the First Trust and Union Savings Bank of Sigourney opened a branch. Since October 1995, this area has been served by the Gibson Savings Bank. The Keswick Oil Company operated from the late 1920s until 1980. Bender Brothers began in 1933 with the running of a DX tank wagon. Since 1950, Bender Brothers Oil Company has operated as an independent oil jobber and is still serving our area. The Farmers Lumber Company, one of four yards left in Keokuk County, is in the same location as when it first began, and except for the demolition of the elevator in 1984, the buildings are much the same. A meal for 40 cents was standard in Bessie's Cafe. 5 cents extra bought a piece of pie. Continuing to provide meals for this area is Teat and Tobes. Implement dealers have been major contributors to our economy. Stroman Hardware and Implement selling John Deere, and C.L. Wilhite Implement selling International Harvester. One of the oldest businesses in town was the one with the Wilhite name. After 69 years in this area, it ended in 1988 when the business was sold. It is now operated as Zitta Green Incorporated, dealing in Ford, Kinsey, and other farm equipment. Other businesses in town at this time include the Keswick Stockyards, with Clarahan Livestock and Trucking doing the hauling, the Keswick Locker, the Hometown Market, the Fashionette Beauty Shop, Casson's Mill operating an elevator and feed business, Keswick Tavern, and Crop Production Services handling the fertilizer, the T&R Service Station opened in 1988, in 1989 a handmade paper business was begun, Crum Construction serves our area, and in 1970 built the four senior citizens apartments. We have a self-help library where you are on your honor checking out and returning any of the 3,800 volumes. A three-truck fire station was built in 1979, manned by volunteer firefighters. Since 1993, the water for the town has been supplied by the Wapello Rural Water Association. Cable television came into town in April of 1989. The American Legion Post, James Murphy Unit No. 319, and Auxiliary are very active and perform many community services. The Auxiliary maintains a hospital equipment room in the Legion building, and the many items are loaned free of charge to residents of the area. The building is also available for use for any community activity. There is a very active commercial club as well as a very community-minded council. Both of these organizations provide support to youth-related activities in this area. We wish to thank Alan Fernie for the use of his pictures. Hayesville Community came into being in the 1880s. Located in Keokuk County, equidistant between the North and South Skunk Rivers, on high ground, from land donated by Joel and Esther Hayes. Incorporation occurred in 1914. Hayesville Community Church was dedicated in 1894. All material and labor were donated. During subsequent remodeling, a basement was added and the building sited. Sunday school is still held, served by a circuit preacher. The church is a gathering place for community activities. A second church, the Spiritualist Hall, also known as the Lyceum, was built in 1896 by donated labor and materials. As well as religious services, the building was used for recreation, lectures, and music. Performers arrived by train from as far away as Chicago, presented their programs, and departed on the midnight train. Due to the coal depot, dancing was held in the warm Lyceum until train time. The Chicago-Milwaukee-St. Paul Railroad came through in the 1880s, making vast improvements in the shipping of grain, produce, fuel, mail, livestock, freight, and passengers. The 1923 report of the Hayesville Shipping Association reported 94 cars of stock sent to Morrell in Ottumwa. A hotel was built in early 1900s to cater to the railroad. It offered 5 rooms and meals. Today, the hotel is a private residence. From 1900 to 1940, a large pickle plant operated, first owned by Squire Dingus Company. Fresh cucumbers were hauled in by horse and wagon to be sorted, brined in large outside vats, processed, and shipped out on the railroad. Frequently, long lines of cukes waited to be unloaded. In 1897, the only lime kiln in the country was operated by J.F. Klein near Hayesville. A deposit of red ochreous clay, 16 feet below the surface, 1 foot thick, 30 acres extent, was discovered, but never developed. Indians are thought to have used the 7 different colors found as ceremonial paint. In 1911, 34 people joined together to form the Hayesville Bank, which opened in 1912 with assets of $340,000. Primarily dealing with agriculture, it was known as the Farmers Bank. During the bank holiday of Depression era, exemption was granted to this bank, allowing it to continue service. Resources grew to over $50 million in 1985, but monetary problems in the 1980s caused the bank to close in 1988, after more than 75 years of service. Elmer Mertz and C.J. Mertz were longtime president and vice president. The closing was a great blow to the entire area. In 1925, Joy Day began, sponsored by local businesses. Parades, music, entertainment, food, baseball, and dancing were enjoyed. This continued annually until World War II. Another business-sponsored activity can be referred to as the first drive-in movie. In warm weather, movies were shown on the rear wall of the school building. Neighbors would come from several miles to sit on the grass and in their cars to enjoy the shows. Our two-story, two-room schoolhouse was added to the historic register in 1992. In the Depression era of the late 20s and 30s, Baseball was king of sports for local athletes and talk of the town for their many fans. The game was played as a way of life. Hayesville's ball club was one of the top contenders, the team to beat. No salary was paid to this semi-pro team. A loss of 6 games out of a season schedule of 30 to 40 games was considered a bad year. Some of the players were with the team for 12 years. During this time, the town was served by a locker, grocery, blacksmith, doctor, barbershop, restaurant, bulk oil plant, filling station, produce house, hoop pole factory, lumberyard, and many more in addition to those already mentioned. Early in the 1900s, William Lovell, a half-black, half-Black Hawk Indian medicine man, came to Hayesville. He practiced herbal medicines and had over 200 customers from all over the county and beyond. Presently, there are 53 residents in Hayesville, 2 full-time and 2 part-time businesses. The school has been incorporated into the Sigourney District, with our young people being transferred by school bus to the school complex 8 miles away. A Hayesville school picnic is held yearly on the first Sunday of June, attended by former students and current residents. Our post office, though on reduced hours, remains open. The first postmaster in 1869 was Joel Hayes. There have been a total of 22 postmasters and officers in charge over the 127 years of operation. Gibson is a small town located 2 miles west of Highway 21 in the northern corner of Keokuk County. It was incorporated December 13, 1954. As you travel down Main Street, you will notice a church, gas station and post office, a bank and the elevator, the propane gas company office, and a fertilizer plant. You will also notice well-kept homes and yards and paved streets. This town was originally Nassau, named after a street in Brooklyn, New York, where George and Lillian Marshall, who donated the land for the town, lived before coming to Iowa in 1874. The Marshalls also gave land for the railroad right-of-way. The railroad was completed in 1880. The deeds and plats for the town were recorded on October 4, 1880, with a clause that neither liquor or gambling would be allowed in the town. All businesses in town have complied with that clause. The name of the town was changed to Gibson in 1903 because of confusion with Nashua, Iowa. Some of the early businesses included, at the far end of the block, the United Brethren Church, Implement Supplies, which had buggies and wagons, a hardware store, a barber shop, a doctor's office, and the tall building was a grocery store. Next to it was a hat-making and dressmaking shop. The restaurant and hotel was where townspeople would gather to await presidential election returns, which would come by telegraph or horseback. The tall building that was the grocery store in 1890 remained a grocery store until 1986. The building was torn down in 1993. The original spiritual ancestors became affiliated with the United Presbyterian Church November 28, 1870. Many of the early members transferred from Ballyroney, Ireland. In 1880, a lot was purchased and a new building was completed in 1881. The church was moved to its present location in 1915 and the addition was added to the front. In 1893, 2 school districts consolidated and a school was built in town. The first building burned in 1910 and soon after, the school that was used until 1968 was built. The school building was torn down in 1973 and a home was built on the site. The railroad depot was a hub of activity in the mid-20s. A passenger train arrived from the east at 10:45 a.m. and came back from Montezuma at 2:45 p.m. every day, plus freight trains would arrive daily. Many businesses moved from Coal Creek, which was located south of Gibson, to be near the railroad. The railroad ceased operation in 1971. A private branch bank was started in 1905 and has been in business since that time, with the present building built in 1974. The elevator was built in the 1880s and lumberyard about the same time. A fire destroyed the lumberyard in 1937, and it was rebuilt where the elevator offices are now. The modern Woodman Lodge, dedicated in 1903, housed on the second floor of the offices, was removed in 1968. The old wooden elevator was torn down in 1981 and replaced with bins. Gibson is a fine town with 76 friendly people. If you come into town early in the morning, stop into the little white house that is the post office meeting place and have a cup of coffee.
We wish that you would research further the Whatcher Historical Society and the Keokuk County Historical Society at Sigourney. In conclusion, it is our wish that this heritage that we have may be enriched beyond measure as the citizens of this county move into the 21st century.